coming up at 10. Extended shopping hours, a major announcement for the Prime Minister as the Haymans flock to grocery stores. Tensions run high at the Department of Social Services. Plus, a man shot and killed along Hampton Street.
News is brought to you by Alive. Believe in best.
Welcome to Our News and thanks for joining us. I'm Kyle Joaquin. A 91-year-old man who tested positive for COVID-19 died in hospital this morning, according to health officials who also confirmed three new cases of the virus. This is the Bahamas' sixth COVID-19-related death. There have been 36 confirmed cases of the virus in the country, 30 on New Providence, 5 on Grand Bahama, and 1 on Bimini. The newly confirmed cases include a 44-year-old man, a 71-year-old woman, and a 41-year-old woman. Health officials say the two women and one man are residents of New Providence and have no history of recent travel. Five people have recovered, according to health officials, who say 344 people are in quarantine. Well, tensions ran high at Social Services Office today as dozens of jobless Bahamians sought food stamps and other aid. Jared Hayes reports.
I have some savings. It's just about depleted.
Philip Hanna Sr. is a taxi driver and former policeman. Never thinking he would find himself where he is, the 60-year-old says he has one priority.
Still have bills, mortgage, everything. I ain't worrying about that part. Because if I don't have anything to eat and I die, they still can't be paid.
With no work, Hanna and dozens of others have to line up for help at social services centers around New Providence. It's a frustrating task as these centers see scores of new aid seekers due to mass layoffs brought on by the coronavirus shutdown. Many of them say the logistics of getting help are a nightmare and they are being sent from one center to the next.
I left my baby sleeping to come out here. And now you're going to tell me I have to go pitch road?
40-year-old Desiree Ramingham-Brister says before the pandemic, she had trouble finding work due to a back injury. She says after getting the runaround at NIB and with a food shopping schedule nightmare, she's at her wit's end.
So what am I supposed to do? I'm not going on the red light. Oh, no. I love my boy too much. I love God too much to go on a red light to sell to get something for my child to eat and for me to eat. No, devil is a liar. I'm not going to do that.
Now, the stories of financial struggle are widespread. Many people at the social services center we visited say they just need food to eat.
Plenty of people have food to eat, don't have food to eat. And the people I'm here and the people cry. It can get scary.
I need assistance with rent, grocery. You got people out here who get but 5 children, and the children them got to eat.
I have 5 kids.
All of them depending on you, of course.
Yes, sir. All of them depending on me. All. So I need that thing. We need to get our government, get some type of MP, some type of representative out here. Help us, assist us, because this right here is ridiculous.
Reporting for Our News, I'm Jared Higgs.
Grocery shopping hours have been extended to 10 p.m. through Thursday, according to Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis, who made the announcement as Bahamians lined up outside grocery stores. Many of them waited for hours in anticipation of a full lockdown, which takes effect tomorrow night.
It's my and the government's responsibility to save lives and save as many lives as possible.
Minnis said heading to and from cabinet meeting Tuesday, he noticed the long lines outside grocery stores, some that went from building to building, block to block. Lines filled with the old and the young gathering from before sunrise in front of food stores. And now with grocery stores open till 10 p.m. Wednesday night and a two-shift system on Thursday, Minnis says this should provide some sort of relief.
We feel that once we extend the supermarket and remove certain sectors, essential service and police, defense force, etc., out of the alphabetical system, that would immediately reduce the load of individuals visiting our supermarkets.
From 6 a.m. to noon on Thursday, stores will be open for members of the Royal Bahamas Police Force, the Royal Bahamas Defense Force, and healthcare professionals. The 12 p.m. to 10 p.m. shift will be open to all those who work in essential services, including fire services, immigration, water and sewage, prison and customs officers, NIB, and social workers, among others. Individuals must wear masks in order to be granted entry at food stores.
I again repeat, there are no shortages, and we ask you to adhere to the social or physical distancing. If you don't, all the work that the government has done in protecting you can be lost overnight. And we do not want a meltdown within our society as we're seeing around the world.
A food store schedule was implemented on Monday to limit the number of people at food stores amid the COVID-19 pandemic. However, stores have been inundated with shoppers. Dr. Minna said due to the rush at the food stores in New Providence, baked goods and water stocks are expected to be compromised. As a result, he said bakeries and water depots will be allowed to open to replenish stocks during the shutdown period, which will end on Tuesday at 5 a.m. Minnis assured that there is sufficient food in the country, but the chaos at grocery stores didn't just occur in Nassau, but in Grand Bahama stores as well.
It would be very helpful if you were to compile your shopping list in advance. That would reduce the time you spend within the supermarket.
Additionally, on Thursday, pharmacies will be allowed to open until 3 p.m.
I ask all Bahamians, if we were to adhere to what we've put forth, then we would be okay. If not, we can experience meltdowns like we're seeing within the other countries.
Wendy's Bahamas confirmed in a statement today that an employee tested positive for COVID-19. Management said in a statement that last week the employee displayed symptoms in the early morning and was sent home immediately before the store opened. Days later, the Ministry of Health reportedly informed management that the employee tested positive. According to the statement, all employees at that location were given a mandatory 14-day leave to self-quarantine. The restaurant was closed over the weekend and its entire exterior and interior have been cleaned and sanitized. The restaurant reopened on Monday with an entirely new team. In other news, a man was shot and killed on Hampton Street off Montrose Avenue today, leaving residents of that area shaken. With more on this, here's Berthany McDermott.
In the midst of this global crisis, police were called to a brazen daylight shooting that took the life of a male.
According to police press liaison officer Shanta Knowles, shortly before 1 p.m. Tuesday, a man was standing on the side of Hampton Street when a black Japanese vehicle pulled up.
One person came from that vehicle with a high-powered weapon, discharged that weapon in the direction of the man, fatally wounding him. As he was getting into his vehicle, an officer was nearby, heard the shots, and he came out to the street. That man, the gunman, confronted the officer. There was an exchange of gunshots. However, the man was able to get back into the vehicle and they were able to make good their escape.
The officer was not injured, and according to Knowles, the vehicle was discovered a short time later through Carib Road off Mackey Street. However, a passerby recounted the horrifying ordeal. He said he was taking a shortcut from the grocery store when a black Paso pulled in front of his vehicle. He said three men emerged from that vehicle, shooting the victim multiple times.
Black Paso. Pulled in front of the vehicle and just opened fire at a young man that was standing. And he must have put about 30 shots in him. One came with an AK-47, the other two came with a 9mm, and he was on the ground and he just continued lighting them up. Pop, 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 pop.
Fearing for his life, he said he ran from his vehicle and jumped over a fence.
Three fellas come out of the car, just pop, 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 pop. It's just time for me to go. Jumped over a fence. And upon going over the fence, I land on my shoulder. I'm not sure whether my shoulder is damaged or what, but got my leg messed up, my hands cut up. Just run for my life.
But that's not all. After fleeing his vehicle, he said the suspects continued shooting at his vehicle.
They must have thought someone was still. They thought someone was still inside of the car. So then they shoot through the windshield. And just where my head was supposed to be sitting, that's where the bullet went through.
As police investigate this latest killing, Noel sent this plea to the public.
This time we have not identified those persons, and that's why we're asking the public who may have information that can assist us to please call us so that we can solve this matter, take these firearms off our streets and these persons who should be off our streets also. Take them off our streets.
Reporting for Our News, I'm Berthany McDermott.
Well, Minister of National Security Marvin Dames assuring the public that officers are more than prepared to handle emergency shutdown measures. He also shot down rumors that officers have been sending in sick slips to avoid working during the lockdown.
For the most part, Bahamians are adhering to the order. Yes, you're going to find some pockets and some individuals who will challenge the authority. Well, the police know exactly how to handle that, and they have been handling it. And so we're confident that our men and women in uniform are doing what is required of them. And we're proud of the work that they do.
Dame says he understands things are tense, but he urged the public not to challenge police officers.
I would have seen one or two of those video clips as well. These are very tense times. The thing is here is not to try and create a confrontation. The police have been briefed, have been told that, at the end of the day, if we're going to succeed here, and you hear it a lot from the Prime Minister doing his press briefings, if we're going to succeed here, it's going to require each and every Bahamian to understand their role. All right, this is not about having a confrontation with the police.
Attorney General Carl Bethel has labeled the 24-hour curfew the new normal. He said the government will continue to rotate between that curfew and more restrictive lockdowns until medical experts give the all clear. Jasmine Brown has more.
Now remember that we are now in a position where the country is going to rotate between two statuses, if you will. One is the 24-hour curfew, which is the new normal. But the Prime Minister has foreshadowed that there will be periods when the limitations are so tight that we call them a lockdown.
That's how Attorney General Carl Bethel described the current situation being faced by residents across the country. Bethel made the comments as he was speaking in the Senate on Monday evening, as he was weighing in on a resolution extending the state of emergency until April 30th. There will be a 5-day lockdown of the country beginning Wednesday at 9 p.m. to contain the spread of COVID-19. Additionally, a complete shutdown will occur every weekend for the month of April. The 5-day lockdown will end on Tuesday, April 14th at 5 a.m. The AG insisted their stricter measures came after residents simply were not adhering to the curfew. He added that the latest information coming from the medical community was also a major concern.
We knew since January that there was asymptomatic transmission, but nobody quite figured out how those persons who did not have symptoms were able to transmit the disease. It is only within the last week or so that a study out of Japan using very high density cameras and various infrared type lightings to identify the virus were able to show conclusively that the virus spreads from asymptomatic people, people who don't have symptoms but who have the virus, by simply breathing.
Bethel insisted that the government is acting on the advice of medical experts and is only doing what it must to ensure the number of in-country COVID-19 cases does not explode. The AG warned that the Bahamas does not have the resources of larger countries and as a result must focus its efforts on prevention. As for the constant changes to the orders and previously unannounced lockdown, Bethel says the government has had to live in the moment as the situation has been ever-changing.
There's nothing here in any of these orders is anything that we on the government side would ever wish to see ourselves in. None of us would ever in a moment have dreamt that we or our country would ever have been in this situation. But we are where we are. We have to do what we have to do.
Reporting for Our News, I'm Jasmine Brown.
Still to come, an Andrus man charged with murder. That and more when Our News returns.
Welcome to Our News and thanks for joining us. Topping news tonight.
COVID-19 remains a serious threat.
Coronavirus COVID-19 has disrupted our economy, tourism industry, educational system, and put our healthcare facilities and professionals on high alert. Are you prepared? Do you have all the facts? Stay tuned to this network for the very latest news and information on this global pandemic.
30-year-old Clinton Forbes of Mars Bay Andrews was charged with murder in the magistrate's court today. It is alleged that on April 1st, Forbes caused the death of Calvin Harrison Roll in South Andrews. According to police reports, officers visited Mars Bay on Wednesday after receiving reports that a male was discovered near the community park with apparent gunshot wounds. Medical personnel were called to the scene and pronounced the man dead. Forbes was not required to enter a plea. He was remanded to prison and will return to court on July 2nd. While the Ministry of Health is working on a strategy to transfer Family Island residents to New Providence for emergency health care if they present with COVID-19 symptoms, according to Health Minister Dr. Dwayne Sands, who said the acquisition of isolation pods is a step in the right direction. Georgia Bain reports.
Following the first COVID-19 death of a woman in Bimini, many red flags were raised surrounding the time it took to get the woman to the capital for emergency health care services. Health Minister Dr. Dwayne Sands said while steps are being taken to ensure that that doesn't happen again, they are faced with a harsh reality.
I don't want to be insensitive at all, but some of the isolation tubes can only carry people up to a certain size. And so we have this peculiar challenge to find isolation tubes that can fit somebody who's 300 pounds or 350 pounds, because that is us. So we're working to get through this. Some of the suppliers simply don't make them that big.
Minister of Health Dr. Dwayne Sands confirming that the country now has in its possession isolation tubes for the transportation of COVID-19 suspected cases from the outer islands. But according to Sands, a flaw has been identified and those tubes are not made for persons who are plus sized.
The pods acquired by Air Ambulance, I think, came at a price of $10,000 each. So these are not, some are reusable, some are not. We also identified additional pods that we had in our inventory from the Ebola crisis. We have also coming in a number of other pods. One of the challenges is that we have to find devices that can fit our population.
With six COVID-19 related deaths, Sands said that it has been more than necessary to exaggerate safety measures because the Bahamas presents a perfect storm for the virus if the disease were to get out of control.
The numbers are small, but if you look at what we believe we know about COVID-19, is that the people that do worse are those with comorbidities and non-communicable diseases. The Bahamas is the poster child for non-communicable diseases. We have a disproportionately high rate of morbid obesity, of hypertension, of diabetes. You put that together with questionable discipline as it relates to social distancing, and you have the recipe for a perfect storm.
Reporting for R News, I'm Georgie O'Bain.
Cable Bahamas Group of Companies announcing layoffs in light of the coronavirus pandemic. CEO Franklin Butler confirmed in a statement that he notified 76 associates from Rev and another 20 from Alive that they have been laid off. He explained that the company had to make difficult decisions in the interest of its survival. However, Butler assured employees of the company's commitment to their financial well-being during these uncertain times. Laid off employees will receive up to 12 weeks of unemployment benefit from NIB, which the company has agreed to advance to those employees. Additionally, Cable Bahamas will continue to cover the full cost of medical coverage for those staffers, as well as their contributions and the company's contribution to the pension plan. Executives have also agreed to take pay cuts over the layoff period and have contributed over $200,000 directly from salary reductions towards an employee fund. Therefore, impacted employees will receive an additional $400 every pay period to assist during the layoff period. Still to come, how a sure win is assisting employees. Stay tuned.
Welcome to our news and thanks for joining us. Topping news tonight.
COVID-19 remains a serious threat.
Coronavirus COVID-19 has disrupted our economy, tourism industry, educational system, and put our healthcare facilities and professionals on high alert. Are you prepared? Do you have all the facts? Stay tuned to this network for the very latest news and information on this global pandemic.
Opposition Senator Michael Darvill says while he supports the Prime Minister's decision to implement stricter policies, he was not a fan of the surprise lockdown that was implemented last week. Darvill said the lockdown announced just hours before it was implemented on Friday did more harm than good.
Last Friday's decision for a complete lockdown brought unnecessary pain and suffering to many Bahamians.
Darvill says he supports many of the preventative measures being carried out by the Ministry of Health, but more can be done to assist those in need.
We on this side certainly support the Ministry of Health recommendations and urge the government to ramp up supportive programs that would not deprive our people for access to food, pharmaceuticals, health care, and essential services. We further implore the government to equip the Department of Social Services, Urban Renewal, and other related organizations with the financial means. We know these are difficult times. We know that there's budgetary allocations at the Ministry of Social Services and Urban Renewal, but we need to ramp it up.
A Sure Win handed out care packages to its employees on Monday. Boxes filled with meat, fish, bread, and other essentials were distributed to the web shop's 200 employees who pulled up and got their vehicles loaded.
So my partner and I, Mr. Gavin Newball, we got together. We got some care packages for our staff members that we wanted to distribute to them. We had this plan for last week, but we had to put it off due to circumstances, you know, came forward by the PM. But we find an opportunity as quick as we can to get these products to our staff so we could help them.
Co-CEO Leander Bryce said the way forward will depend on the industry. However, he said it's their role as employers to look out for their employees during their time of need.
It's a package to get you going through this time. Something you could, you know, you could have a belly full. You know, you can nutrition. It's hard to get the food stuff. You've been on those lines. They're ridiculous. I mean, and it's a quick way to get the product to the people.
Still to come, a college athlete shares his hopes for the future. Stay tuned.
Welcome to our news and thanks for joining us. Topping news tonight.
COVID-19 remains a serious threat.
Coronavirus COVID-19 has disrupted our economy, tourism industry, educational system, and put our healthcare facilities and professionals on high alert. Are you prepared? Do you have all the facts? Stay tuned to this network for the very latest news and information on this global pandemic.
And finally in news tonight, college basketball player and NBA hopeful Kai Jones is sharing his hopes for the future once the world emerges from the dark cloud that is coronavirus. Marcellus Hall has that.
One of the feel-good stories coming out of these moments is the fact that we had one of our top collegiate basketball players seeing his first action coming out of Brewster High School, playing his first year at Texas for the Longhorns. Talking about Kai Jones, who talked with us earlier about his season and what's ahead.
So it was a very significant moment for me. It felt great because that's something I've been working towards since the age of 12, 13, you know, in my teenage years. So when I got the chance to do that and step out and show what I can do, you know, it was very significant and it was a fun moment. I enjoyed every second of it.
You know, you guys had a up and down season. You started kind of slow, but at the end there, as you made that push at the end, you guys kind of caught fire. What was the difference there? Did your chemistry kick in? What was the difference, you think?
I think we were just playing with a lot of fight and, you know, playing with that chip on our shoulder as, you know, we're down a couple guys, but we still believe we can get it done because we're a confident team. So once we believe we can get something done, we can get it done. We're very hard workers and we all get in the gym a lot. So when we got our chance, we were able to live up to the expectations because all the work we've been putting in.
When you guys got the word that basically it was done for the year because of this, What did you guys talk about as team and what was your first thought as an individual?
You know, it was a very abrupt ending. You kind of don't know how to feel because in that moment, we're in the Big 12 and we hear that tournament's canceled. So, you know, there's a lot of hope that we can still play in the Big Dance. This will be all over with. At that moment, I don't think we knew how impactful this thing was, that this was actually that would put countries in a state of emergency and be called a global pandemic. So once we realized that and the tournament was canceled, it was just a very sad feeling. It's like, you know, you charge up your mental battery and you get your body ready to play in these crazy moments, but you don't get to do it. So mentally, it's kind of disengaging because it puts you back because you get so excited to play these games and you don't get to play.
Now you've had a year under your belt as a freshman. You kind of know what to expect now. How do you see your role changing heading into the next season?
I see myself going in and being an impactful player out of the gate. You know, somebody who's coming off of a freshman season of growth and is continuing to get better in the off season. I've been working on my game every day, working on my body. So I plan to have an even bigger role next year.
So our thanks once again to Kai Jones for taking a moment out to speak with us on his season. Looking forward to seeing great things from him coming up in the very near future. For our news, I'm Marcellus Hall. The weather is next.
Thank you for joining us for Our News tonight. On behalf of the entire team, I'm Kyle Joaquin. Remember, you can catch Our News on the go with the RevGo Play app. Have a good Tuesday evening, Bahamas.